because my next guest is the sexiest man in the world, and he is going to sing, just for me, one of my favorite songs, Crazy. Welcome my friend, Julio Iglesias.
You look beautiful. Crazy. Crazy for feeling so lonely. I'm crazy. Crazy for feeling so blue. I knew you'd love me as long as you wanted, and then someday you'd leave me for somebody new. Do you remember that time?
Thank you for that beautiful song. It's just so wonderful. So wonderful to see you. Julio, before I get you talking, I have to say thank you, because back in 1985, I met Julio on The Tonight Show, and you gave me my very first job in show business, which was traveling and opening for your show, and I thank you so much.
No, there has been many years, many, many years since I didn't see you.
Right.
So your last time passing through the hotel in California, and I was following you, amazing your career.
Thank you.
But the most important thing I have for you, let's
talk about this.
I have a very big memory.
You have a big memory?
Yeah, yes. And you remember?
I remember.
You know, when I met Roseanne, she was so sexy, so attractive to everybody in all the band and myself.
Right.
We had fun. And I remember then one night, you had to remember very well.
I do remember.
I woke up in the morning with something here in my hair. So I give you back.
Thank you. Oh, thank you, Julio.
I keep it there.
And I have to say that today, when I came in your trailer and saw you without your pants on, it brought so many memories back. Of the many number of times that I saw you like that on the road.
How many times we had fun?
I don't want
to tell everything because it would be too red, you know, too red. No,
yeah, it would turn red. I used to say, when I opened up for you, I used to say that, you know, you were trying to have an affair with me, and I told you that you weren't my type because I like them bald-headed with great big beer guts. Remember? But now you have to take Viagra. I read in the Inquirer you're on Viagra. and it's not working.
No.
You're taking Viagra, but it doesn't work, right? That's what it said in the magazine.
No, no. I don't take Viagra in a normal way. I put in my ear.
That's why it doesn't work.
Yeah, exactly. But I think then Viagra is not bad for somebody like me, 77 years old.
No, you are not 77 years old.
These people are going to be there.
Are you 77 years old?
No.
Now, how old are you?
I'm 50 enough.
I can't, like, have a big fat crush on you if you're in your 70s, honey. I just couldn't do it.
We have to be very honest tonight because it's the first time I see you in many years.
Yeah.
I had fun with you like I never had fun with any women in my life.
Oh, my God. Thank you.
Ever. You were the most funny women I ever in my life met. Because I remember that time, then suddenly we were all together and I heard that noises. And I was looking around and I said,
I did not do that.
He has
such a liar. I never farted. I never farted in front of Julio Iglesias.
You did it.
I did not.
Yeah.
No, that was that Swedish model you're with. And she tried to blame it onto me because she didn't want me getting next to you.
No. I think, no. It sounds very familiar that now, but I remember then was coming from your side. You were sitting. It was very always there. But that's something then not very, it's okay. That was something that happens. The most beautiful thing happens maybe is to see you through the years in so many changes, so beautiful changes.
Yeah, thank you.
With so many marriages.
Yes, thank you, Julio.
But how many did you marry?
Well, I've been married three times in total.
You met the first husband.
You met the first husband, then I didn't see you. The second one, we've all forgot about. And the third one.
You're happy.
I have a happy marriage, and I have a
five
little baby,
kids.
Five kids. How many kids do you have?
Officially? I have three.
Big
ones, a new one, and another one coming.
Check them!
So
it's working for you. You're very happy. I think I met the person that you know you're married to. I met her. You've been with her for a while.
Yeah, I've been for so long. It's too much.
Too much. You know, I have to now. Let me be a fan.
Yeah.
Okay, stop joking around. I have to be a fan of how great a performer. Like seeing you opening for you in the Superdome in front of 30,000 people. I've never seen anybody perform like you do. Let me just say it. And where does this voice come from? Where does that voice come from?
My niece. It's coming from my niece. It's coming like this. You get into my stomach, and it goes through my throat. And
I mean, it's so masculine, because, you know, like a lot of guy singers, they kind of sound like girls with a deep voice to me. But you are all man, all masculine. And this is what, like, the best thing you do, this drives me crazy when he's like. I mean, you're just so awesome.
No, that's natural.
So what? I can just imagine.
It's a part of.
You've been with over 3,000 women, haven't you? Well, that's what your secretary
without,
said.
Without counting you.
Without counting
which
me.
Which you is like 2,000 in the same time. No, that's not it. I've been having fun in my life, but with always respect and discipline. You know that.
I know.
Discipline, but I had fun. I regret doesn't have a little more because now it's different.
But
it's different for you too.
No. It's different for me too now that I'm
I
in my 40s.
I can see that in your eyes.
You do?
Yeah. I can see that you go through many changes.
Why? Oh my God. Oh my God. We'll be right back at the Apollo with Julio Iglesias.
La vida está en New York.
I wrapped the little panties around it. This is your retrospective, My Life, Your Greatest Hits. It's out now.
It took me a long time to do that.
Yeah, it did take you a long time. These are some awesome songs. It's your whole career on here.
Yeah.
It's great.
A lot of time.
What's your favorite song? Can I ask you that? Your favorite song to sing?
I don't have really one. It depends on the moment. If it's depends on the audience more than anything. It's like you know, when you are doing your show and suddenly you have something to say, you say something else and it's much natural. Depends on the days. I don't have a favorite one, no.
Are you, how much, like, talk about, like, you know, off the top of your head you go when your favorites change and everything? So that brings me to this big subject. You have a lot of superstitions and stuff that could, like, change your mind at any time, right?
Yeah, I have. I used to have more than. I think aging has been changing a lot of things, but I used to be so superstitious and I couldn't even walk.
You couldn't even walk?
I had to do many things. I was thinking.
If people spilled salt in the room, you had to leave, right?
I had to take my salt and to put all over my shoulder like this, and to take after my bands, many things.
And I have to do everything five times. You have to do everything?
Everything five times?
Well, you know, like turn off lights. Like, if I turn off lights or wash my hands, I have to do it five times. I have all those crazy things. You got a lot of those.
No, I had to do five times. I had to make love five times. You know, because
really?
Every year.
Every year?
No. I had superstitions, not so strong, like five times things. But for example, I used to go on a stage without touching. I had to touch everything, surrender the stage, the booth, and nobody could touch me before I go on a stage. For the energy, only the people, only the public. It was.
Is that like how you retain? Is that how you keep energy. Your energy and
but
take it in?
It changed a lot. It changed, but it was too much. It was a moment then I was really living through that situation. It was too much for me.
How'd you get rid of it?
With discipline in my brains. With, you know, thinking then it was getting over to my brain, something like go out on the stage, couldn't go without touching every single booth, means Whatever it was, Booth, I had to be touching Booth. So it was crazy watching for Booth all the time.
Now, well, generally performers really have something crazy about them. Almost all of us, I think, we have something really like that.
But this is a pain in the ass because you have to really follow that every day, every day.
And try to live your life around all that ritual.
Yeah, it's a ritual. And
but what you have the most discipline of any performer on earth, because tell us about like this car accident that you went through and it totally changed your life. I love that story.
I had an accident when I was young, when I was 19 years old. And I was paralyzed for 3 years.
Paralyzed for 3 years?
Yes, completely in bed. And so I understand very much, maybe the people now, they're watching television and they will understand the kids who has a problem and the families who suffer that problem with the kids or with some members of the family. When you get paralyzed, your life changes completely and there's a lot of kids and a lot of people paralyzed. I was lucky and I recuperated myself because I had only a compression, not a section in the nerve system. So I get back through a lot of exercises, a lot of therapy, a lot of things happen for years and years. Still today, you know, still today.
Right.
Sometimes when I go on a stage, sometimes not every day when I go on a stage, my balance is not very good because my nerve system is not complete. So.
But like from being totally paralyzed, you worked in your head to bring your body back and it totally changed your life, didn't you? Because you didn't even sing at that point. You were a soccer player.
No, I was a bad singer. I'm a bad singer. I didn't sing until I was 24 years old.
Did you just like one day you're laying there and you make a decision to become a singer?
No, I couldn't move my hands, so a doctor gave me a guitar to make therapy in my fingers. I wrote the songs. I introduced with the record company. The record company said to me, you are a bad singer, but you do not bad songs. So I said, okay, well, leave the songs for the artist. And one day they called me and I sing a song and until today.
But how did you know that you could sing and you're not a bad singer? You're like one of the greatest singers that ever lived.
No.
Yes, you are too. How did you know that? Yes, you are. Yes, you are. You move us to tears. When I opened for you, like I tell you, like the Superdome in Madison Square Garden, women were weeping. I mean, before they even saw you, it's like I look out and I'm trying to do my comedy and it's like, oh. I mean, that's what an artist does, is move people to that. I've never seen it before.
That's what about. I don't think that I was a good singer ever. I just have my emotional things together here. You know, I love to sing. I need to sing. I can't survive without singing. It will be my life all the time. That's why I'm still surviving, because it's not very easy. It's not very easy. And I love to sing. It's the only thing I love, really, the most. Everything we talk about, the women, we talk about girls, it's something, subject to maybe it's good for a conversation, but reality is then I'm a singer.
Now. And did you know it your whole life, though? Because usually, like, you know your whole life that you're going to sing or that you can sing. But I'm just fascinated with the fact that it was so late. Did you know all the years up to that point?
No. When I was young, I was not interested in music. I was just interested in sports, interested in my career, and loved my university degree. And I started to sing because of the accident. And now I know that I will sing until you let me sing, until the end, until I die. I don't have anything else to do than that. That's the most important thing in my life.
Is that where, like, you have... Is that the place? I just want to ask you, this is going to sound crazy, but I want to ask you this. Is that the place where God touched you?
Is that the place? Then I don't have to think when I'm going to die.
Yeah.
That's the place, then...
That's the place where you don't have to think about dying.
Yeah, that's the only place, then I feel secure.
And how remarkable is it, I have to ask you about your son, because also to give birth to like a great singer too.
Yeah, Enrique is doing great.
Enrique Iglesias.
I have another one also.
Oh, really?
Julio is...
Do you ever feel like spanking your son because he's so good and so good looking?
I think then the genes are amazing.
And he's like your chief competition, too, isn't
no,
he?
No, I said, no, don't put that to, because he's a young kid. He has to...
Well, he's like the only guy that comes close to selling the number of records that you've sold.
He's a great, great seller. He's a great kid. He's a very independent. He's a sweetheart. And he's talented. But I have more kids, you know, and sometimes... And they want to be in show business. For me, it's not very easy because I had to divide my love through the other ones. And it's not easy for a father because one will be a doctor, one will be a singer. It's already different. But both, they want to be a singer, Julio and Enrique. So wow. I had to divide all my things into talk. I think Julio is going to be also great. He's amazing. You will love him too.
I can't wait to talk to him so I can ask him about things you did when they were growing up.
I was a bad father.
Were you a bad father?
Yeah.
Why were you a bad father? Because you were busy?
Because I was always escaping of everything. I was always involved in my life, in my career, and I was not a good father. So I cannot presume to tell in front of his eyes that I was a good father. I've never been a good father.
But are
you
now?
A good mommy. You are a good mommy.
Are you a good father now?
I'm a better father.
Better father.
I still, you know, a good father is a man who goes to the school with the kids, take the lessons to the kids, he wake up in the morning at 6 o'clock, he take them in winter. That's a good father.
Sometimes that's what a good father is.
Sometimes
a father just passes on one great thing and he's a good father too. I just want to say that. I'm so happy you were here. We're going to go to commercial, right? We'll be back. So happy you're here.